Alright, all right. So we're live. So yes. We're still getting our shit together here, everybody, so bear with us. You may not even be watching us right now. Chances are probably nobody's watching us, but whatever, we're going to fly by the seat of our pants and have a really good show. So, without any further ado, I'm one of your co-hosts, Tim from ChadoMecha.com, the one and only. So we're, like I said, trying to get our shit together. So,
Really good show. So
he's got the echo.
That's
he's got an echo.
It was me, but now it's gone. Sorry.
Good job. Wow. You think we were professionals at this, but we're not. Surprised. Anyway, so I was going to share a link around Facebook, but we went live, so I didn't have a chance to do that. So if somebody get a chance to do that, that would be really, really awesome. Introductions, I think, are in order. I already introduced myself, so let's go around the panel and introduce all of our co-hosts. Let's start with our newest co-host and everyone's favorite Aussie, Mr. Josh Dara. Josh, go ahead and introduce yourself, buddy.
Hey, everybody. Josh Dara. I live in Australia, in Brisbane, and it's summertime here, and damn, it's hot. Oh, my gosh. And I like drawing Gundam, and I like building Gunpla, and I entered GBWC last year, and I was fortunate enough to win the Australian leg. I have a website where I have all my prints and artwork that I like to sell, and Facebook and Instagram, all Joshua Dara, and I post all of my latest Gunpla work on there and modifications, and I love chatting to everybody on there. So that's me. And I like skateboarding as well. I always got to put that in. Yeah.
Cool. Well, thank you, Josh. Appreciate it. All right, so let's go over to our next co-host, everyone's favorite Englishman, the gentleman of Gunpla, Mr. Simon.
Hello. I'm Simon of what is known as Gundam UK, and I am a mecha modeler and blogger, and also admin on the UK Mecha Modelers group. Hello.
Excellent. Thank you, Simon. And then let's take it over to our resident Mr. YouTube. Zach, go ahead and introduce yourself, buddy.
Hello, I'm Mr. YouTube Zach Aurelius. And here in the midst of moving to a new apartment. So what once was full is now my very empty desk.
Wow, look at that.
So sad.
Yes.
Sad times.
In Korea, usually people pay a cleaning company to clean your new apartment before you move in, but it's quite expensive, so we decided to clean it ourselves. It's not a good idea. We should have just paid.
What? So wait, you have to clean the apartment before you move into it?
Yeah, you don't have to clean when you move out.
That's awesome for the people leaving, but not for you.
Yeah.
Wow.
So, got a long day ahead of me today after this. Lots of cleaning to do.
Awesome. So what's the subscriber count up to now, Zach?
15,280-something.
Wow. Not bad. And you just broke 15 the other day, didn't you?
Yep.
Wow. So that's like you got 280 subscribers in like a couple days. That's pretty cool, man.
Yeah, it's usually pretty... The average is between 30 or 40 per day.
Wow.
That's amazing.
Good job, dude.
Thank you.
Well, and then we have our sometimes co-host now, Mr. Jim and Boo. Jimmy, introduce yourself, buddy.
Hey, guys. I am Jimmy and Boo, or Jim, or sometimes I go by Gunpla Fixation, which is my YouTube channel. And I'm more of a behind-the-scenes type of guy at Gunpla Talk. I, from time to time, show my face for a few minutes while I take a break from work. But I've been doing Gunpla for a few years. I'm very slow builder. I like to take my time with my kids. That's pretty much it. I've dabbled with military modeling, but Gunpla is my passion. And that's my story, and I'm sticking to it, guys.
Fair enough. Well, hey, Jimmy, thank you for joining us, at least temporarily, man. Appreciate it.
Yep.
Love having you on.
I'll be here.
And let's transition into our two guests this time around. We'll introduce our first guest, Mr. Clay Geller, one of our favorites. Clay, go ahead and introduce yourself, buddy.
I'm Clay. I am actually the head creator of It's a Gundam on Facebook. I'm a mecha modeler right now because I'm in Wisconsin. It's kind of just a snap builder, but hopefully I'll be getting back into painting real soon. Don't really do anything other than Facebook because it takes up most of my time. So that's where you can find me.
Very good, very good. All right, so, and last but definitely not least, our man of the hour, our special guest this month, and might I add, your 2015 GBWC Grand World Awesome Champion, Mr. Nguyen Aimong. Introduce yourself, sir.
All good, I'll close it up. Hey, y'all, I'm Nguyen, and I just got up, so I do apologize beforehand. My brain is still trying to function. You know, rebooting thing is very, very slow computer. Right. But, yeah, I'm from Thailand. 6 o'clock, I think, in the morning. See, the sun is almost up. Almost. Look at that. Oh. Right. Anyway, yeah, but I'm broadcasting from Thailand, and happy, very, very happy to be here, sir.
Awesome. Well, we're happy to have you on, so thank you for joining us. Thank you for getting up at the butt crack of dawn, and hopefully we'll have a really good show. We'll talk to you about your experiences and your techniques and all that good stuff, so awesome. But before we do that, everybody knows, we like to talk about a little bit about what's going on in our own unique little worlds, kind of what we're doing, what we're working on. Nothing really has changed for me. I'm still working on the Hummingbird, although it is progressing nicely and moving towards a finish. I'm painting the last two pieces of the puzzle right now, and it's more like detail painting, so they should be done probably, hopefully, in the next couple days. So that's all I have. So, Josh, what are you working on, buddy?
I haven't been doing any building, really, because I started my new drawing, and my ballpoint illustrations, they take about 30 hours total to do, 30 to 35, I spent about 2.5 weeks, and I have just finished the Sinanju.
Wow.
Awesome.
Oh, that is sexy.
I'll bring up a screen share to show everybody.
I want to print.
Yes.
I got a print of NZ66 off him. It was awesome. I have it like hanging up in my next room, autographed everything.
Man, that was so much fun. Giving those out to everybody. So can you guys? Can you see this?
So
I took a photo of my Sinanju and took it in direct sunlight, so I get a lot of stark shadows and highlights, and I've just slowly gone through and done it up, and it's probably my best work so far, but that also means it took me the longest time.
Oh, wow. That's beautiful.
Yeah.
That is amazing.
Sorry?
It does not look like a drawing. It looks more like a photograph.
Oh, yeah, man. Nice compliment. Good.
Yeah.
I can tell you I draw it at cafes and restaurants and everything. And while drawing, I am so scared that I'm going to spill coffee or some soy sauce.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, I know. And I actually feel bad for the waitress or the waiter that comes by because they'll be dropping off my food, and they'll see the picture sitting there, and I'm drawing it, and I'm scared that they're going to spill it, and I wouldn't be mad at them. I'd feel bad for how bad they would feel for wrecking it. As soon as they come by, I quickly put it away so there's no chance of them wrecking it. Yeah. So now I've finished that, I can actually start building again. So now I can probably start on my GBWC. So back to the actual plastic now. Yeah.
Awesome. Well, that thing definitely came out beautiful, man. That looks like a winner. So, what is that? Now that's just pencil, right?
It's a ballpoint pen. So
oh,
it's
ballpoint pen. Wow.
Yeah, it's. I don't know if you can see one of these little guys. So it's a classic pen. But I went and tested out maybe about 20 pens in my local pen shop. And modern pens, the ink is too smooth, too good. This is actually a crappy pen, so it comes out really dry, which eventually looks pencil. So I test a lot. And then when I buy a packet...
Keep it careful, always the way to go, my friend.
Yeah, that's it. So yeah, ballpoint pen, yeah, which means you can't erase it. So it's a bit of a challenge, yeah.
That's awesome, man. That's even more impressive that it's a ballpoint pen, you know? If it was, like, graphite or something like that, it would still be awesome, but the fact that it's ballpoint pen makes it even cooler. So,
office pen.
So I'll have that, for anybody who's watching and likes my artwork, I'll have that up on my website for sale probably in about a week or so, but I'll announce that all, yeah.
Cool. Cool.
Amazing.
Very good. Very good. All right. So moving on to our next esteemed co-host, Simon, what are you working on, buddy? We know you just finished a model, right?
I did, but I just can't top what Joshua's just done. That's too good. It's amazing.
How'd you follow that up?
I don't follow that up. I did. I just finished a GP04G RE100 model. I stuck some pictures up earlier today, did a video. And I've just started on one of these Typhoon Cerberus models from Muv Luv.
Oh, nice.
So I'm just stamp fitting that at the minute, and that's all.
Are you on a bit of a big gun kick recently or something?
Yes. Yes, this has an insanely long sniper rifle, so that's part of the attraction.
Very cool. Well, hey, GP04 really looked good, so congratulations.
Thank you. Yeah.
Very good stuff. Zach, aside from the move now, what are you working on? Anything good?
As soon as the move is done, I need to finish up my Master Grade Wing Zero custom that's been very slowly being worked on. That one just needs decals, that's it. Just decals and top coat.
Very cool.
After that, probably going to be starting on Mega Size Zaku, build off with Henry.
Oh, cool, cool.
Oh,
Mega Sized. Nice. What are the plans for that one?
That's going to be a gift for my friend in Japan, my best friend in Japan. He and his wife own a cafe. And so going to like paint some like custom design on it, kind of to match their cafe. And also planning on maybe a couple of the parts, planning on doing that nail polish in the water, like hydro, dipping, what's that called?
Like the dipping, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
I've tried it a few times, but I need to practice it a little bit more to get it to work really right. But I think that'll look cool on some of those armor parts.
Yeah, definitely. That'd be great to do something like that and have it in a cafe. That's cool.
Yeah. So it'll be nice to be like just outside their cafe something. And I'm gonna, I think because it's the standard Zaku that comes with the heat hawk and rifle and bazooka. So I want to build scratch build like the rack piece that you can attach all the weapons onto the shoulder armor.
Yeah.
Like a Black TriStars kits, I think. And other kits come with that. Of course, the Mega Size doesn't have that piece, but it's a really easy piece to scratch build, I'm sure.
I have that when I finish kit, and I have all these weapons, but they can kind of only hold one. And I'm like, no, I want to load them up. I want to put it all on, so I'll like drill holes, extra pegs in, so they can just have it all. Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm thinking about that,
buddy. Just a little idea, right? You know those toothpick that you have a floss at the end? You know that curved toothpick.
Oh, yeah.
Basically, you just cut the toothpick off, and you have that arch thing. So it's a pretty good weapon rack for that size. Maybe. I don't know.
Oh, man, that totally makes sense, yeah.
Mm. Yeah, I have one of those. Or I have some of those. I'll have to see if it would be the right size that might work, but...
Keep it cheerful. Always cool.
Yeah, it could work.
Nice.
At least as a base, and then like build some plot plate around that or something.
Yeah.
But anyway, that's it. So lots of stuff to get working on. My new space is going to be bigger than this, which would be nice. And so, yeah, looking forward to that.
Very cool. What kind of new videos do you have for us?
New videos, the new video series that I want to do, I talked about a little bit before, is the Gunpla quick fix videos, which would be like small little tutorials about something specific, about a specific kit. So like just some fixing something or some little mod that you can do, like just for something for some kit. So I don't know. Could be
like the Sanju waist peg.
Yeah, something like that, or like for some HD kit, just like drilling out the Vulcans in the head or something, or making, one of the things I'm planning to do is making some just funnel effects for the HGUC Cubelay Revive by just using clear rods, and just things like that.
Very cool, very cool. Okay. Awesome. Well, thank you, sir. I appreciate it.
Awesome. Yeah.
So, Mr. Jim, it looks like you got some parts drying back there. What do we got?
Oh yeah, working on my kitbash. I don't know if you can see. It's the commission build. Finally got some primer. First time I've painted in I think, I don't know, 10 months or something like that.
Yeah.
So really missing it, but I'm really enjoying it right now because I love to paint and use the airbrush. So right now I took it out of the dry booth because there's some parts that, since there were a lot of mods on this kit, primer just reveals everything, like every little line that you miss sanding or whatever. So I'm going through the parts, just inspecting them and just sanding and fixing and re-putting and doing all that sort of stuff. So I'm almost done and it's ready for the second coat, second stage of primer. And I'm hoping to put the first base coat of paint maybe tomorrow. So this weekend, even though I'm working, I'm not too bad on my schedule, so I can have some time tomorrow in the afternoon to squeeze in a nice paint session. So we'll see how that goes. I have a ton of video again. People have been asking me. A guy today sent me a message like, when's the next video? And I'm like, soon, guys. So just stay tuned. I have a ton of video. Some of it is in the editing bay. So the idea that I want to do is I just want to get this commission done and out the door so it gets to my client, which, by the way, he's in Australia, Joshua, so I hope it doesn't take long to get there, but
I talked to him. He said, take your time.
That's good. So, he's an awesome guy. He's very patient, and I basically, when he hired me for the commission, I did tell him, I'm extremely slow. You got to be patient with me, and he said, yeah, no problem. So, but I do want to get it done because I got a bunch of stuff that I want to, my personal projects that I want to continue. And so get that done out the door, and once that, my idea is to post the entire whip. What I usually do is do it by parts, part one, two, three, four, whatever. But since I have all the video basically recorded, I'm gonna basically, my idea is release like a video a week. So you probably in a month's time, or do like in four parts, week one, two, three, four. So you can see like the entire process from start to finish. So that's kind of like what I'm thinking of doing, and then get back to resin because I really want to get back to resin, because I started working on resin before starting the commission, and I just basically fell in love with it. I think resin's not for everybody, but if you're the type of guy that likes to get his hands dirty and do a lot of model work and a lot of fixing and sanding and all that stuff, I enjoy that type of stuff, then resin might be for you. So other than that, not much, man. Just hanging in there.
Jim, that's a pretty cool
t-shirt. Is the dog working on anything?
Oh, the dog? He's my faithful companion, so. So, yeah. What, you were going to say something, Zach?
Yeah, how's that t-shirt? Looks pretty good.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, now I realize what it is. Cool.
Nice. Yeah, it's my Zach Aurelius t-shirt.
Nice.
Good. Yeah. I was going to say, Tim, that's a new sweatshirt. Can you show that for a second? I wanted to see how that sweatshirt
looks. Yeah, well, you know. It's the Reapers. So,
many designs to get.
Huh? Awesome.
I had to actually go through two orders to get the right the right style and the right fit and everything, but I think I found the good one, so yeah, I'm gonna try to convert all the other designs over to sweatshirts and hopefully get them up sometime. I want to finish the Hummingbird first, that's priority, so don't hold your breath on the sweatshirts at this point. So they'll be coming, let's put it that way, soonish. So, but anyway, hey Jim, real quick, one of the guys in the chat asked if you still have that Zeong that you're working on.
Actually, I do. I still, that's the resin kit that I'm kind of focused on, but I put it on pause for the commission. But I am still working on the Zeong. Once I'm done with the commission, I'm gonna jump back into that and work on that and the PG ashtray that it's almost done basically painting. I just gotta finish painting a couple of armor parts, decal it, and put it together. It shouldn't take long. But yeah, the Zeon, I'm loving the way it looks. It's a solid kit. There's a lot of detail that I had to replace, but it's, I'd say maybe 90% pinned and sanded and whatever. So I got a little 10% of some issues that I gotta fix and finish pinning, and hopefully get ready for the first coat of primer. So I'm really, really stoked and looking forward to it. So it is my build off with my bro build with Matt Morozik. So hopefully, if he sees it, he'll get motivated to start on it again. Even though he's like swamped with work, and on top of that, he started a new kit this week, which was the Deep Striker from Mechanicor. So, but anyway, yeah, I'm looking at it right now, and I just absolutely love the way that kit looks. So I'm really stoked to get back on it and hopefully finish it. So
nice, awesome. Well, brother, thank you again for being with us. Appreciate it. So, Mr. Clay, you said that you were just kind of snapping stuff. What are you working on, dude?
Right now, I'm working on this guy, the EXS. It's actually my Holy Grail kit. I've been wanting this forever, and I'm quite surprised how well it is for a 2003 kit. But like I said, it's actually starting to get warmer out here, so I'm going to be starting to paint soon. So, yeah,
nice.
Right now I'm also, ever since the last Gumbla talk, I'm also I got a Nightingale, and I want to start using Josh's tips for doing the scribing.
Yeah, good one.
Points for Josh on that one, man. Good job. Cool. Well, man, you got plenty of time to work out any issues with the XS and get it painted, so can't wait to see it, man.
Yeah, me too.
Cool. Well, and then let's go back to the man of the hour. I'm sure he's got some pretty cool stuff that he's working on. Wynn, what do you got on your bench right now, man?
What?
Sorry.
You broke up a bit. I apologize.
Still too early.
it's all good. What are you working on, man?
Very professional. I apologize. Oh, right. Basically, right now, not really anything. I'm just building. I kind of have an idea for like one single build, and I'm actually fitting like I think 15 Zaku 2s together.
Oh my god.
It's in the other room right now, but it's just a random crazy idea I have. Basically, after I think first four, I could have like done all of it without any instructions. I'm just like, bop, 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 then done. Right. It's nearly there. I got like a few more to go, and it should be fine. I kind of have like a diorama idea for like Billy Don't Be a Hero, you know that song. I don't want to say old song because I still like it, but like it's a song, Billy Don't Be a Hero, and yeah, it tells the story of that, basically. It's just a random thing I have in my head, and no one's here to stop me, so there I go.
Awesome. Well, yeah. You just finished up your Clash of the Titans build, didn't you?
Yes, I did. January, yeah, around ish time.
That thing looked awesome, man, and I love your dog that you sculpted. That was cool.
Yeah, I'm Wedley. He's in the other room as well. You want to bring him in?
Cool. Yes, why not?
All right, 1 second.
Maybe I should get my cat in here.
Yeah, do that. I had a bad opinion.
Look at that, buddy.
Oh, there he is.
He attacks me all the time. Like, every time I'm trying to do Gundam or whatever, he comes by and just bites it, right? See, like, Ewoks and mechs don't mix, you know what I mean? Like, it brought down an empire.
He's adorable.
You're funny.
Oh, he's funny.
I basically, you know, did that steampunk bit with the dog based on him. He was just looking at me. I want to put newspaper in there somehow, you know, just tell a story, right? I figured the most logical thing is have a dog and a bit of piss and shit on it. So, there he is.
Awesome. Well, that's cool, man. Well, thank you. That's cool. All right, so, Spawn, let's get into another regular segment of ours, and that's the news. So for that, we're going to throw it over to our regular news guy, Mr. Zach Aurelius.
We have the news of that P-Bandai, this is something kind of funny, I don't know if you guys have seen this, so let's talk about this, that P-Bandai...
What?
I'll be back.
Ixnay, on that one. If you're referring to what I think you're referring to.
No, I'm not. Sorry.
The thing.
I know what you're thinking of, and that's not what I'm gonna say. So no.
Okay. Cool. Because somebody messaged me about that.
Prototype. And, so, like the P-Bandai prototype Zaku. I forget the actual name of it, but it's the Zaku like with the Dom legs.
Oh yeah.
You know what I'm talking about? And I figured, like, I posted up about it, like, on my page that I was expecting a lot of people to be like, ah, why is it P-Bandai like usual? Like, oh, I really want to get that, but it's going to be so expensive. But, like, all of the comments were people saying, like, oh, that'd be so easy to kitbash. All you need is to buy, like, a HG Zaku 1, HG Zaku 2, and an HG Dom. It's like, so you'd prefer to spend more and buy buying three kits and then have loads of wasted parts and then... rather than just buying one P-Bandai kit. That's like
that's a very fair point.
So I don't know, though. That was funny. Then there's the 1-100, actually, P-Bandai version of this kit, the Schwalbe Grays, the 1-100. Just as a side note, this is a much better version than the standard version. Some of the problems that I had with the standard version are now gone in this version, so...
Nice.
That's good.
That's awesome.
The P-Bandai version of that, the purple one, the Gaelio version, does come with the lance, so that's cool about that. It's not just a recolor. So I believe that's the only way that we're going to probably get a 1-100 lance for that, if you want it. That's pretty cool. Otherwise, there hasn't been, because, you know, it's not the magazine time yet. That's still 2 days away till we start getting the new magazine news. There's that P-Bandai stuff that came out, and that's pretty much it.
So nothing crazy interesting?
Nothing really, yeah, for me anyway. I talked a bit, in the last episode of Gunpla News I did, I talked a lot about the 1-100 scale, there's a new kit that they were showing off, like, just the silhouette of, you know, how they've been doing that for Iron-Blooded Orphans, showing the silhouette images first. And the silhouette's just of the Gundam frame, but the price is, like, more expensive. So, I don't really know. I thought that's really interesting, anyway. I'm curious to find out what that is going to be.
Either whether they know how to tease.
Yeah, right?
Yeah.
So we can see the information, yeah. Like, the cost is higher and the box size is larger than normal. But the silhouette is just the frame, so I don't know if it's going to be just like a really detailed frame. It's like a really, like, much better frame for the 1-100 scale kits. That might be cool, because then you could basically turn the 1-100 scale kits into, like, more like a master grade by having a better inner frame.
Yeah, maybe they'll work in elements like the, what's the high resolution Barbados that's coming out? Maybe they're working in more pistons and things like that that you can actually put together.
That's true, but that's going to be a pre-built frame.
It's such a weird setup, this release. You just can't work out what it could be, because it's all the price that throws you off.
Yeah, I don't know. So, I mean, it's possible
that... both frames. The Gundam and the Grace frame.
I'll tell you what I really think it is. What I'm probably gonna put my money on is that it's just the Gundam frame and then a bunch of like add-on parts, weapons and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Like a weapon.
Kind of like the new Gundam thing, right? That big hammer dude.
Yeah. So like,
weapon by one boss is getting two colors too. But
I've seen those before. They're called frame arms.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's good.
So, like, everyone wants a 100 scale mace. So, like, I'd assume that'd be one thing is a mace, one of the Barbatos, and then, I don't know, maybe some other stuff. Or maybe a 100 scale mobile worker. Who knows? Mm. I don't know. But something like that, I'm guessing it's going to be the frame and something else, because if it was anything other than the frame, then they would show the silhouette of whatever it is. So
cool. Well, yeah. Isn't C3 going on right now over in Japan?
Yes. I haven't been following much of the news about that, but I've seen, you know, stuff here and there posted about it. But yeah, there's been a lot.
I saw, I think, how do you say it, Naoki, the modeler, really... Mm-hmm. Crazy Naoki. Good modeler over there. I know he's got some, I guess, signature high grade kits coming out. You know, and I think one of them was, I think the date, the release date was released. It was a new version of the EZSR.
Okay, the Maxim.
Like purple version, which is really cool. So that should be interesting. And I thought I saw some news on. The NX Edge little super deformed deals.
Oh, yeah.
I saw some new ones, but I don't know. I don't keep track of them. So hopefully we'll get some really cool stuff out of C3 here in the next couple of days.
The EZSR Maxima is a Bandai Pro Shop kit.
Oh, okay.
Is the story with that. And then the Next Edge, they announced the Next Edge Hainu and Nightingale. That's pretty cool.
Oh.
Yeah. If you guys are, I haven't gotten any of those Next Edge figures. If the unicorn and the banshee ones look really cool though, so might pick up maybe one of those. But if you didn't want a really huge kit of the Nightingale, you can get a Next Edge figure. That'll be good for some people.
Yeah, because that's
sort of like a lot of potential for modification with the Nightingale, like a smaller thing. If you want to.
Oh, sure. Yeah. That RE100 is a monster.
When I first
saw it online, I never even imagined how big it was until I saw it in person. And then once I saw it in person, I'm like, holy hell, that's really big.
Ouch.
Yeah. So cool. All right, awesome. Well, Zach, thank you, man, as always, for the news. So let's get into... the meat of the conversation. Let's talk to Wynn about everything. So, Wynn, you just won GBWC. I mean, the cream of the crop in terms of Gunpla competitions. Tell us about it. Walk us through kind of your experience and everything. How did it feel being up there on stage and being handed that monster trophy in the whole nine yards? Talk to us a little bit about that.
I can't show you the trophy, sadly. I don't have the trophy. The company who brings Gundam into Thailand has the trophy right now.
Cool.
Like, both the one in Thailand. There is going on a roadshow around, my model as well as the trophy. Like, around Thailand. Cool. That's what they do, more or less, every year. I'll get it back in October. And when I do get it back, I don't have it in my house because my mom wants it. So it's at her house. So I'll never, ever get that. But, the event, it was awesome. It was really, really awesome. Really did not expect to win. I just want to go there to meet people. Like, I met Josh. He's awesome dude.
Hey, buddy!
Internet high five. It was awesome. But basically, there was a lot of really cool entries for this year. And I think they announced the third place and then the second place. Mm. And then, the thing is, we had this little earpiece where they translate from Japanese to English, right? Kind of okay-ish. You kind of understand, get the gist of what's going on, but not really. But mine happens to be broken.
Oh,
and, couldn't say my name all that much. So, basically, third place now, second place now. And then they announced the first place, but I didn't realize it was me, so I sat there like an idiot, still clapping, waiting for the winner to go up. Right? And the guy punched me in the rib, going, "That's fucking you, idiot." I was like, "Oh, crap." And I went up, and I still don't know what the hell they're saying, right, because it was broken. Because, the judges, right, they're there just going, how good it is or why it won, what this thing is, why this, why that. I had no clue what he was saying, right? But the guy next to him, right, he kind of nodded and agreed, so I just followed him. Like, whenever he nod, I'll nod. So, no idea. He could have been saying, "It shouldn't be you on there. Why did you come to Japan, you idiot? You don't deserve to be on stage." I'm just there, just agreeing with him. For all I know. But yeah, it was very, very surreal. It was very, very surreal. I'm glad I won, though. It was fun. It is really, really fun. But like I said, you don't really join the these type of competition for like the winning. You join it to meet new people, to share technique, share experience, have a laugh, basically. The people there is more fun. Right. I mean, we're all grown men still playing with toy soldiers. We can't be taking life that seriously, and that's who I want to hang with.
What a great philosophy.
Yes. That's awesome. Yeah. We've heard that obviously. From Josh, he had said that last show and everything about it's really about the meeting the people and the experience.
Oh yeah, definitely.
That's awesome, man. That is awesome. So, when you walked up there and they handed you that big golden Gundam trophy, I mean, what was running through your head? What kind of feelings were you experiencing?
Happiness interlaced with a lot of confusion. Like, not really having an idea what the hell is going on, but I was like, I won, I actually won, wow, for Thailand kind of thing, right? But yeah, just a lot of happiness, a lot of happiness. Because, like I said, I didn't expect to win. That piece, the thing I did was sort of like an experiment, and it sort of is kind of personal for me, that piece. It's sort of like me trying to communicate what we do to other people, non-Gundam player, non-model makers kind of thing, right? But instead of modeling, I use carpentry. It's more or less the same thing, but different skill set. Mm. So basically, I'm just trying, the amount of practice we have to go through, it's not just like, blah, 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 we're done. Oh, look at that, it's beautiful. It takes a lot of time to get your your thing, right? A lot of model have to be sacrificed for your skill to be to a certain point that's presentable. Basically, I just wanted, like, the crap we have to go through as modelers for it to look good, at least to us. You know what I mean? And usually we do this after work, so a late night, that's the name kind of thing. So I'm just trying to, like, you know, tell that story to everyone. And I think the ultimate test was my mom, because she has no idea why or what I'm doing, you know, for my hobby. She's like, you're a grown-ass man. Why are you still playing with toys, Wynn? But I'm like, Mom! She still calls them doll, actually. She don't call them toys. She calls them dolls.
Did you tell her mom, Tarsha? That's even worse than calling them Transformers.
No!
Oh, heathens. Anyway, yeah, but my mom saw that, and she got it. She got the story. I was like, that's exactly the same thing as modeling. She was like, all right. And then she carries on with her day.
Did you have any damage happen to it in the transit over to Japan?
Oh, man, the head fell off. The arm whip thing fell off as well. But I was there like a day or two beforehand, and I went with the company, right? Mm-hmm. And they went to like that Japanese onsen spa thingy. The hot springs, right? Mm-hmm. So basically, they were like, "Oh, Wynn, come on!" And I was like, "I gotta fix this." So they went on doing that, and I was just like stuck there in the room with super glue, oil paint. I'm going, "Better dries." Panicking.
Oh man.
Yeah.
I saw that big case that you took it in. So you just carried that on the airplane, or how did you even take that?
Yeah, there was two boxes, right? One's for the actual main piece, and the other one's for the base.
Okay.
Right? So it was in different parts, but yeah, basically we just I just chucked it on a plane, kind of thing. I have a lot of Warhammer sponge, right? So basically I just packed it in that. Like, a lot of that is good stuff. Oh, and I stole a lot of makeup sponge from my girlfriend, right? It's really good for carrying models. You know, those makeup sponges is, like, a lot softer than usual. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, the triangular ones, yeah.
Yeah, and it just fits into random little slots. So, yeah, it's really good. I stole a lot of that and then just Warhammer sponge shit.
And man, I was curious.
It was nerve-wracking, though. It was very nerve-wracking.
Yeah. When was the first time you did the kind of wood effect on a kit? Was this the first time, or did you do some practicing beforehand?
I tried loads of different ideas. I found some off the internet, and I tried it out. It didn't go well. I think I still have the remnant of those somewhere. Those experiments. This technique that I did was, I think, the 10th technique I tried out. It actually worked. I took it from home decoration. You know, those wood grain tools.
Yeah.
Essentially, you know, those wood grain tools, obviously it's too big, right? So I made, like, little patterns, like, round little patterns on the computer, and I had it made into, like, one of those rubber stamps.
Oh, whoa.
And I cut that out and then did that. Basically, you use acrylic first, and then you wait for that dry. You put oil color, because it dries slowly, right?
Yep.
And then you you use the wood grain tool on it.
And
you like rubber sculpting tool for the
slide it across.
Yeah, basically.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's very creative.
I tried that. Yeah, it was fun. It was really, really fun. But the annoying thing about it is because I use oil color, it takes ages to dry, like a week.
Wow.
So basically, you do it, you leave it there, just forget about it, and then come back later.
Man, that's crazy! Wow.
Was it your first time in Japan?
Oh no, it was my second time actually. I went last year as well.
Okay. Oh yeah, I remember.
Yeah.
Did you have any time to like do other things besides the show? Did you get to like travel around the country or do any sightseeing, or was it just kind of go?
This year, or last year?
Oh, no, this year.
Oh, this year. Basically, we went there. The company brings Gundam in to Thailand, right? They usually set up a thing, right? It was different this year, actually, because we went with the tour as well as the company.
Okay.
So we went to the Mount Fuji, you know, the hot spring thing, and then we got, like, we split off from the main tour bit to go to the event. So that was pretty cool. So, yeah, a little bit of Japan, a little bit of, like, the areas around Tokyo, if you know.
Nice.
Right. Because usually, last year when we went, right, we just went for 3 days, which is, we got there, we did a little bit of sightseeing around Tokyo, and then we went for the event kind of thing. So it's kind of cool doing things differently this year.
Yeah, but 3 days is like nothing, you know. It's like, before you know it, it's done. It's over. You're back home, right?
Yeah. Oh, man, the best thing about this time around, right, I actually got to see Mount Fuji, right?
Yeah.
I went to Japan five times, right? Never once have I seen Mount Fuji.
Whoa.
Right? Every single time we go there, they're like, oh, cloudy sky. And I'm like, I'm at the foot. And they close off all the roads because it was, like, really foggy and all that. So basically, up to a point, I don't believe that Mount Fuji existed. It's sort of like, I want to believe, like, the X-Files kind of thing. No, right? No. I think, like, Japan, like, you know, photoshopped it in, you know, for tourism and all that. They come, it's like, oh, no. It's cloudy. You can't see it right now. All
right. It's up there somewhere. Just believe us. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, you got to believe in it first to see it. Yeah, but I actually saw it this time around, so, like, I believe.
Was it worth seeing it, or was it just a mountain?
The whole mountain.
Yeah, okay.
It was the whole mountain. Was it one time? Never seen the mountain. Even when I was supposed to be at that viewpoint where it's like the best point to view Mount Fuji from, right? Cloudy. They're like, oh no, cloudy, very cloudy.
Oh, like, what? So after all this time of not seeing it, was it worth seeing it?
Oh yeah, it was beautiful. Don't get me wrong, it was amazingly, amazingly beautiful.
Okay. Well, no, for the next...
I heard a story about it as well, where it's like a little pilgrimage where Japanese people they do a trek all the way up to Mount Fuji to watch the first sunrise of that day.
Well, man,
right? How beautiful is that?
That's
they,
cool.
They go up to a certain point, they sleep, and then they wake you up to walk the rest of the way. It's like a little tour kind of thing. They guided track up to see. The first morning of that day of the world, basically.
Yeah.
To, like, get the first surprise kind of thing.
Yeah. Man.
You gotta love the Japanese, man. They're awesome people, and they just have such discipline. It's crazy.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, it's a beautiful tradition as well, along with the new stuff. You know, it just goes hand in hand, like a good balance.
Cool. Very cool. So, let me ask you now. After you won, from what I've seen, they have like interviews and stuff from all of the press and the hobby magazines and everything. So how did that go? I mean, what's the experience like on that? I mean, that seems like almost chaotic, almost, you know, from the limited amount of pictures that I've seen. How did that go?
Oh yeah, it went fine. Pretty much like this. They just asked me a lot of stuff. The funny thing with Thailand is a lot of people who do interview, they do things to save face or like, oh, look, I'm great at this or whatever kind of thing. But, like, I'm brutally honest about everything. Like, I'm just an idiot with a ponytail. That's true in life. That's the answer to go. I am, right? Most of the time, I have no idea what I'm doing, right? Even most Gundam builds, I don't know what I'm doing. I kind of have an idea. And I just make it up as I go along kind of thing, right? But they refuse to believe that I do that for some reason. Like, they don't think I actually don't know how to use an airbrush. That's the honest truth. I really don't. I don't own one. I tried using one, but it scares the crap out of me. So I just never really did it, right? I use paintbrush, and they don't want to believe that either. Mm. So... it's just me trying to convince them, like, look, I'm an idiot. Seriously, I don't know what I'm doing, right? But I kind of got there. I kind of got there at the end. I failed a lot, but I kind of got there at the end.
Kinda.
Kind of. By winning.
So in just that short amount of sentences that you just said, the number one most amazing thing that I took away from that all of your kits are hand brushed.
Yeah, that's amazing.
I don't know about you guys, but I'm blown away by that. Honestly, that's awesome.
That's really cool.
I mean, the thing is, I got used to doing Warhammer. You know, like those miniatures.
Yeah.
It's just brushing, right? Like, there's no right or wrong way of doing anything. It's just a tool you use to create an effect. Airbrush and brushing is more or less the same thing, but different skill set. Like, an airbrush can do everything a brush can, and a brush can do more or less everything a airbrush can. You know, but it's just a different skill set, and, like, it takes more step or less step for each one.
I think that's a good thing for people who are watching who are maybe new to the hobby and working out if they want to get an airbrush, because once you start the hobby, eventually people are like, you should get an airbrush and get into the painting with that, which I agree. I love my airbrush, but this shows that you can do anything. You can do hand painting. You can buy little tubs of paint and put it on there with a brush. Each airbrush or hand brushing all takes practice, but, man, this is the grand champion of the GBWC, and he hand paints it. So everybody hear that. It's great. You can do it.
Exactly. That's awesome.
I think a lot of people don't have the paint.
That's so awesome.
I remember I did hand paint not a Gundam kit. It was just a military model, and it came out all right, but it's just, I think a lot of people go the airbrush route because it's, I guess, faster than there's some things that you have to deal with, but if you guys remember Cam, right? Simon, I know you know Cam, right?
Amazing.
He's an advocate for hand painting, and back when he was on YouTube doing videos and stuff, he used to do tutorials on hand brushing, like what type of brush should you use and all that stuff and different techniques and stuff. So it's definitely a fun way to do it. Come again?
He even did like lighting effects.
Like
a red light on just hand painting that without an airbrush.
And I think he used to. I remember he used to use a perfect gray spoon to show his techniques.
Perfect gray spoon. Yeah. I remember that. Yeah.
But hey guys, I gotta jump off. I got a meeting. Gotta get back to work. But I just wanted to say hi. Congratulations again, Wynn, for GBWC.
Thank you.
And Josh and everybody else. Thank you for everything, and I'll see you guys soon. I'll still be hanging around in the chat. I'll go into my meeting, but I'll be chatting around while I listen to the meeting in the YouTube. So I'll talk to you guys later.
Cool. See you, Jim.
Thank you, Jimmy.
All right. Take it easy, buddy.
Bye-bye.
See ya.
Bye-bye.
Awesome.
There he goes.
Like
I said, there's no right and wrong way of doing anything. It's just preference. It depends on what you like and what you're more comfortable with. Basically, I think the one main thing with airbrush that I don't like is just a personal thing, right? I tried to use it once. I got like a normal undercoat, a base coat color kind of thing, right? And then I masked it off, right? And then I did like another tone on it, which I thought was perfect at first, right? And then when you take the masking tape off, the whole thing comes off, so you have to, like, sat it down and do it again.
That hurts.
That's the worst.
So I'm just like, you know what? I'm starting over. I'm brushing this thing.
Man, we have all been there, and I'll tell you what. For me, masking is like torture. It's the worst.
It is, isn't it?
I'm going through it right now. And I literally want to gouge my eyeballs out every time I have to look at that stupid tape.
Horrible. Yeah, see, paintbrush, man, it just goes around. It's fun.
Oh, man, I'm not that skilled, man. I'm not at that level right now. So I'll stick with the airbrush and just kind of slog through it. But still, it's bad.
So, Wynn, do you have any favorite other artists, Gunpla artists, or even Warhammer painters, or anything that you really like their style or their customizing? Do you have any favorites?
Well, I really don't want to say this, but Kevin.
Yeah.
The American winner kind of thing. like I said, I really don't want to say it because he might be watching and it'll just blow up his ego even more.
I'll deflate it. I'll deflate it. I hate the guy. He's just so annoying and he's not fun at all.
He's an idiot. Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, his work's great, huh?
He sort of like infuses fantasy and sci-fi together. Even last year, he sort of like goes like a little bit of Chinese culture in there, a little bit like fantasy mixed in with like, you know, on a Gundam, which is sci-fi. So I just find like I like that mixture of like genres kind of thing. But he's
what's that?
Yeah, he's a dick.
Nice. So for everybody that doesn't know who we're talking about, Mr. Kevin Zhang, Mr. Dash on Facebook, check him out. Awesome builder. He's despite popular he's not a dick. He's pretty cool. So.
Yeah. Yeah, he is very cool. He is very, very cool. But we rip the piss out of each other a lot. And to be honest, Josh, I am very jelly of your skills as well, like, you know, with the scribing and like the way panels and all that. I mean, that's infinite patience I can't be dealing with. But it is amazing. I cannot work clean like you work really clean. And
this is what's so cool
about it. Just blows my mind.
When we got there to Japan, seeing, like, I know my style and how my kits look, and seeing everybody else's, like, yours, the painting, looking at it, I didn't even know how you did it. And I found it really cool seeing all the other entrants and looking at their approaches and trying to kind of calculate how they got the finish that they did. And it's cool seeing where everybody's strengths are. Yeah, it was great.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just, you know, the different styles and everything are always cool to see. It's just like, you know, especially over here, I mean, the builders in the U.S., man, there's a ton of different styles. And, I mean, you talk about Kevin, I mean, his modifications and scratch building and everything like that are so clean and so crisp and so tight. You know, and then you compare it to, you know, say like Wynn, you know, where he just, you know, he throws paint on there and it just makes it look so epic and so real and so dirty and nasty and grimy, but so freaking cool. But then, you know, you got Josh on the other end of the spectrum who does just, you know, massively clean stuff, you know, with these awesome precision panel lines that you would think a robot did.
They are amazing.
Man, you know, hands of a surgeon over there, you know. So, you know, it's cool to see all the different styles. So that's awesome. That's really awesome. So so let's talk about here real quick. Let's talk about inspiration, because that's a big thing I know for a lot of us, you know, on the show and everything like that. Where do you find most of your inspiration? What, you know, what kind of resources do you kind of utilize to kind of get that idea rolling for your next project?
Anything, yeah. Really. Oh, wait. Oh, you're talking to Clay or... Sorry, who are you talking to?
Talking to you,
man. Oh, right. Okay, sorry. Jeez, Clay, me. It's all about me today.
Man, Clay just jumped in there, man. He's just like, hey, you know, I just got an idea.
I'm here.
Clay can go first. I'm kidding.
I actually just go on here. Like I said, I'm going to use Josh's tutorials for the scribing. I watch and look at Wynn stuff all the time and get all his tips. And it's just going on the forums and all that and learning. And it gets me inspired.
That's awesome.
Well, you got a cool resource in that group of yours, man. What's the user count up to?
Let's see here. It's at about 9,500. Yeah, 95, basically.
Nice.
9,500.
That's not too shabby. That's pretty decent amount of people. So that's really cool. And that's a good, that right there is a good source of inspiration, too.
Yes, it is.
Cool.
I can vouch for that.
So what about you, man? Where do you get inspiration from?
Basically anywhere and everywhere kind of thing. Like I said, this project that I'm doing right now, it came from the song Billy Don't Be a Hero. So, like, it can be, like, the music I listen to or, like, a random piece of art I saw on the internet kind of thing. I was like, oh, that's awesome, right? Like, the way I see Gundam, I don't see him as, you know, like, Gundam Strike Freedom or a Zaku or whatever kind of thing. I actually see him as parts. I know that sounds kind of bad if you have, like, you see a pre-Bundai thing. It's like, I just want the head.
You know, I noticed that with you. I noticed that with you, like, all of your things.
I like that arm. I'm going to grab the arm.
Yeah.
Yeah, so basically, I just have, like, an image in my head of what I want, and then when I go to my Gundam shop, I'm actually just looking for random little parts that'll fit the puzzle I kind of have in my head kind of thing. I was like, yeah, that'll do, that'll do. And then all the parts that I'm not using, I can use it for another project, maybe, or scenery. I have, like, a whole wardrobe full of Gundam bits. I put them all together first, though. So I don't come, like, later on and go, what's this? What is this? Right? You know what I mean? You kind of have an idea of what it is, and then I can rip them apart later kind of thing. So I put them back, put them together and then rip them apart.
So when you were in Japan at I think it was Yellow Submarine, how they have on the wall there, they have all the bags, and each bag will have one or two runners from a particular kit. And
that is awesome.
Yeah, I take it you love that?
I do. I didn't buy any of it, sadly. Right?
Wow.
I bought the all those like little like Kabuto, you know, those like detailed up little sprues thing. I just stocked up on that. I stocked up on decal, right? But no, I saw the thing. Basically, guys, in Japan, right? They open up a box and they display parts, so you can get like a Sinanju booster only, or the arm of Grays only, or a weapon of like the Camphor only, kind of thing. And they sell it in like little packs, like little stapled bags. So you can just buy that little bit and then glue them on, kind of thing. Which is pretty cool. It's like Bits Barn.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I do love that, but I didn't get any because I figured, like, you know, like for a little bit more, you can get the whole thing. Yeah.
The price was just a little bit less than like the kit, and I'm like, man, I was curious. What's the community like over in your area and your country? Like, do you have actual physical meetup group builds, or is it mainly Facebook? And like, are younger kids involved in the hobby, or is it mainly older people?
Oh yeah, it's really really huge here in Thailand. I mean, like, it's been big even before I started this whole. Well, I started like 2 years ago, but like, it's just been big ever since I was a kid. Gundam, Japanese, we have a thing for, like, Japanese anime, right, and Gundam building modelers, right? If you're a modeler in Thailand, you will be doing Gundam, even if you're doing, like, Tamiya tanks or Warhammer or whatever kind of thing, right? You will be doing a Gundam kit, right? And it's really, really big. You have, like, random little shop scattered all around Bangkok, and each of them are their own little community, so they get together to do a build, and... that's just Bangkok, though. You get this with all, like, cities everywhere, you know, on the outskirts of Bangkok, you know, on the outskirts of Thailand and all that. Right? Wow. You go get Gundam Builder somewhere around Thailand. Yeah.
So that's great.
Really, really fun. Yeah. And you know how, like, in America, right, when they do the GBWC, they have, like, regions, like the northern region and all that. We get that in Thailand as well, because, like, there's a lot of builders around. So basically, they do, like, different regions. The winner comes to Bangkok in October, and then the winner of that goes to Japan.
Okay. So did you go through, like, semifinals to get through to actually go to Japan?
Yeah, basically. Bangkok is sort of, like, the place, right? Last year when I entered. The first year I entered, there was, like, around 150 people, entries, rather, that came in. So that's quite a lot. But last year, like 400 people. that actually entered.
Whoa.
There's a lot of really, really cool stuff on there.
Yeah.
Kind of thing.
Oh, that's crazy. So that makes it even more impressive that you got to Japan. That's a lot of other entries to go up against. Wow.
I mean, the wood one, right? Like I said, I was quite worried about the diorama that I did because it's sort of like, it's not a Gundam. It is a Gundam concept, but it's not really, if you know what I mean. It's not like robot, mm-hmm. right? It's sort of, it's wood. It's a person making it out of wood. But it did came out of like a Gundam universe. Mm-hmm. Like my idea was, right, I want to make a diorama within a universe because it is a Bandai and Sunra kind of event, right? So you have to link it with their universe somehow. So I made it out of Gundam Built Fighters, the series.
Yeah.
Because if you look, there's like little details in there that shows it came from there, like Worthy Rivals, that's one of the episode names.
Yes.
There's like a little mosquito repellent thingy that came from one of the episodes. You know, that wood block, the school that Mao went to,
mm-hmm.
right? The wooden plaque is on there on the side as well, right? So it's like all these little details, their logo, their icon is actually on the plaque as well at the front.
Yes, you know, that's with the little hexagons, right?
Yeah, that's one. Yeah, so basically little hints in there that it belongs in that universe, right? But still, it's just a lady sculpting Gundam out of wood, showing her appreciation and all that, right? Mm. And the thing next to me was this awesomely huge Trigon, you know, the lion thing, but they made it mega size. Like, they took a mega size Gundam and they modded into that thing, right?
I think I've seen that, yeah.
Yeah, oh, it was epic. It was huge. And mine's just like a little thing compared to that thing, and I'm going, wow. Can it be like placed next to a junior or something? It just makes mine look a little better. Yeah. But yeah, there is a lot of people here, like a lot of community kind of thing. Yeah.
Did you have a favorite entry from Thailand that you really liked this year?
I did. I actually gave some of my prize to him.
Oh, nice.
I was hoping he ranked, right? It's one of those, like, it goes by really, it's underappreciated, I feel, right? Mm. Basically, he's a ball, MG ball, right? Mm-hmm. But he made into a racer, like, with wheels coming out like that.
Not cool.
With, like, a little, like, you know, like, figure kind of thing. I was like, that is awesome. That is epically awesome, right? And no one liked it because it was, like, you know, like, small, and you can pass by easily without actually seeing it, but I thought it was epically awesome. I just gave him my prize. Like, dude, I love your thing, man. Here, have this.
Nice.
That's really cool, man. That's really cool. So, let's talk about here real quick. Everybody likes to talk about build process and how we do things, especially people watching that, you know, are really just kind of starting out. So talk us kind of through, what's your process when you start on a project? I mean, from you know, step one all the way to when you complete it, what's your process?
Well, basically with me, I kind of have an idea in my head, kind of, of what I want to do. And then I find the parts for it. Now, I think the fun is in the hunt for the part. It might not have to be just a Gundam part. It might be, like, for my Graves build that I'm doing, is a build-off, and with Josh as well, and, like, 20 people around the world. Mr. Dash, Kevin, he's the one that put this together because he had this idea of, like, one kit, 20 builders, 20 different ideas, which is awesome. It's kind of like, you know, like, what he can do with one kit, you don't have to go with the instruction, different ideas and all that, right? But with that kit, I thought steampunk, because that's my room. So, yeah, it needs to look good in my room when I put it there. So I thought steampunk. And I used parts from watches, as well as Gundams, and, you know, I sculpt my own parts and all that, right? So basically, have an idea, kind of like a rough idea. Don't, like, sketch it out. Don't have to be exact. Kind of just a very, very rough idea. Find the part that is close enough. It doesn't have to be perfect, just close enough. and then put it together, you know, kit bash, take things out, whatever kind of thing, and then, because sometimes, right, you will make an you will fail, and you'll have an accident, but you like it. Like, you accidentally, like, cut and nick something. I like that scratch there. I'm going to keep it there. Right? If you don't like it, just putty it up. You know, just randomly do stuff, right? Don't be afraid to fail. Because if you fail, you learn what not to do. You know, you learn more that way. But, yeah, it's kind of have an idea. Put parts together and just make it up as you go along, basically. As long as you kind of get to where you want to be, kind of, you're good.
Nice.
Very cool. And, you know, and that's really great.
The most important thing with Gundam is have fun with it. Don't be stressed, right? It is a hobby. It's not work, unless you're doing commissions.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I support that fun aspect, too. You just want to be loving it. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. If you're stressing over, oh, man, I can't get this line right, you know, don't do the line. Don't worry about it. It's fine.
That's awesome. Well, I mean, and that's really good advice, too, you know. You know, have fun with it, but I also like that you said don't be afraid to fail, because I think, you know, a lot of people, especially when they started out, and I know me, you know, I was scared, you know, shitless, you know, wanting not to mess up a kid and everything, but I think trying to get over that fear, man, it just opens up a world of possibilities, so I really, really like that. You know, that bit of advice, that's really, really good. So, hey, man, you know what? Let's open it up to the chat. Let's get some Q&A from the chat. Let's see if anybody's got some questions for us here. So if you're in the chat right now and there's a bunch of you out there, man, ask us some questions. And you know what? If you're lucky, maybe we'll answer it for you. So we'll give everybody time to do that. And let's talk about real quick. Let's talk about what's going on It's a Gundam. Clay, I know you got something going on over there. You got like a little competition or something, right? What? Tell us
just
about that.
Just a little one. Just a little one. Yeah. So like I said in the last one I was in, we are doing a In Rust We Trust. In honor of Wynn, actually, for winning, because he is actually one of our admins.
I can't enter.
Well, that's because you won last year.
Sorry.
But it's our annual contest. We usually have a theme, and this year's the Rust. It's actually Rust or Battle Damage. And this year, our prizes are MG Sinanju, and then the Plavsky Particle Build Burning and the Build Strike. And these are all actually being donated by Wynn himself. And so you actually have the choice if you win him, if you want him to sign them or not. So you have a piece of Gundam history.
Yeah,
and
nice.
Then also...
No.
And then
Gundam
so we have
reminds everybody Gundam history, awesome.
And then also we have one that our grand prize that we want to do, but it's kind of conditional on like sales because we're kind of the group that's for community by the community, and so if the community contributes in, we're gonna put up the high res Barbatos, which
Ooh,
is like
nice.
A.
Ooh.
And how you participate in that is you go to Child Child of Mecha's store envy store and you buy either the It's a Gundam shirts or Wynn's paint pusher shirts, those portrait ones that you see all around Facebook. Yeah, he made those and he was gracious enough to help make us make us shirts. So you just have to buy those.
I just sent the picture,
man. Also,
for you.
The one cool thing this year is that we're actually doing trophies. And if Wynn would like to show them off, he actually painted them up for us.
Oh, that's great.
Oh, that is awesome.
Right. That's the first one.
Oh, wow.
Second one. If I hang on, bear with me. And the third one, if I don't drop it. Right, if you look, it's kind of like the logo. It's a Gundam logo as well.
Ah, nice.
Yeah.
I'll take a picture of it, and I'll put it up on It's a Gundam later. But, yeah, there you go.
And the, like, Gundam Kids prizes is cool, but having a trophy, really, there's something about it. Like, when you're a kid getting trophies.
Yeah.
It's so cool. That's great you guys are actually giving trophies. That's awesome.
Yeah. And also... just to give a little oomph to getting those shirt sales, we're actually going to be starting a raffle off that the winner of that is going to win a 00 riser from Win 2.
Wow.
And he has offered either you can have the kit or he can build it in his signature style for you.
What?
The hand painting.
Okay, I'm going to go buy some t-shirts. I'll be back in 10 minutes, guys.
And like we'll have the full description of the rules on how to enter the raffle, but basically you just have to show yourself in the shirt with the invoice in your hands so that just have it by the end of the contest, which is in the last week of April, and then we'll announce the winner of that during the prize winners of that.
No photoshopping, I'll be checking.
Yeah.
Nice. That's awesome, man. Well, you know, and guys, yep. It's a really, really cool competition, and you know, the group is an awesome group. If you guys aren't familiar with It's a Gundam, it's probably one of the best, if not the best, Gundam groups on Facebook right now. I think all of us are members of it. You know, a lot of the people that we talk to are members of it. So if you're not a member, man, go join. It's awesome, and there's a lot of cool builders and a lot of cool posts and all sorts of really good stuff. So go to It's a Gundam and get on board. So very good.
Yeah.
So all right. So let's actually get back here to the chat. Because we've gotten a lot of pretty cool questions here. And you know what? I'm going to start off here real quick off the bat with a really simple one. This one is for Scuffle in the chat. He wanted to know what my favorite feature of the Barbados was. You know what? I think my favorite feature of the Barbados...
The eyes.
Are the runners that it comes on. The runners are really cool. You know, they're very symmetrical, and I really like the runners. So
yeah, the vertical and the horizontal.
I think those are pretty cool. So, what's that, Simon?
Just saying, you like the vertical and the horizontal bits, and maybe the little circle in the middle.
Yeah, exactly. Those parts, you know, we can talk about those later. But the actual runners, man, top notch job by Bandai, man. Sorry, I had to get that in there.
That was good.
So let's see. Here's one actually. There's one for Simon actually. Yeah, man. And you know, since you haven't been doing too much talking here on this one, I thought we'd throw that here to you.
Go for it.
Let me. Where is it? Where did it go?
Are you gonna find a particularly tricky one?
No, it was a softball, man. It was. Okay, I'm going to go off my memory here. It basically, what's your favorite kit?
What's my favorite kit?
Yeah.
Oh, wow, that's actually very difficult. So far this year, in the past 6 months maybe, it's probably the GPO 4G, the RE100 model.
Mm. Yeah.
It's just in terms of detail and engineering, I just think it's great. It's just so well done.
Even with the bad proportions?
Even with the subjectively bad proportions.
Sorry, man. I had to get that in there.
Actually, no. My favorite kit I've ever built is the NG Dual Gundam. I really enjoyed that.
Really?
Kit. Yeah. Fantastic.
Nice.
Good. Not
what did you think about that? What kind of things?
It's just the fact that it's like it has these additional armor plates on it. It's just in terms of looks, I just think it's the best kit I've done for a while. So
very cool, yeah. And it looked awesome too.
Yeah, yeah. I want to do another one. Oh, plus the Jester. I really like the Jester. There's too many. That's the thing.
Yeah, you got to get a Jester in there, man. The Jester is totally pretty badass.
It is, so. Yeah.
All right, so let's see what other kind of questions do we have here. All right, so for Wynn, yep. So a couple people, and this is combining a couple different questions here. So Rockin'. When did you actually get into modeling, and how?
Right, I actually started out when I was 13. But it's for growth miniatures, fantasy based. From there, but ever since then, I'm watching like a lot of cartoons, like anime and all that. Until Gundam Build Fighters, people don't know what Warhammer is or Games Workshop. It's basically miniatures, right? You collect it, you paint it, you build it, and you collect a whole army, and you can use it to fight each other. Simulated warfare, basically. If you seen like. You know, like old movie when you get generals on a battlefield and they're like, oh, I'm pushing this with a stick. I'm pushing this unit with a stick to hit that unit. It's basically that, but you use dice and all that, right? So essentially, I started out there from when I was 13. And then when Gundam Build Fighters came out, the idea of a modeler, right, that can put his plastic model onto a magical table and it comes to life and fights each other, I'm sold. Bandai so knows cool, right? How to sell their stuff, man. They really, really do. I'm going, oh, man, I don't do Gundam. But I have to now, you know. And it started from there. Yeah. And I never looked back since. Like, the horse thing I did last year, that was actually my first Gundam that I actually ever built. The Jirzulu on the horse.
Yeah.
It started from that one, then it became a diorama, and then it, I entered it and all that. Yeah.
Wow. So the Four Horsemen that you did last year was your first Gundam models?
Yeah, one of them. Number 8.
Wow.
Actually, no, number 10. 8 second. Yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
All right, so for everybody out there, think about the progression. So from 1 year building your first Gundam model to world champion of GBWC.
That's pretty
impressive. Your dreams can come true if you dare to believe. All right, PSA is over.
Like I said, I don't mean to do it. I just do it for fun. Just do it for the love of the hobby. Like, yeah, right. I don't do commission. I actually have a day job and all that stuff, right? But when I come back home from work, it's a pleasure. It's a pleasure doing it. I just relax with it. I build. I I can't be bothered playing a game. I just sit there and just put the stuff together, rip the stuff apart, and just build. It's fun, you know. Can't stop. They hooked me.
Very cool. All right. So then this next one is for Clay from Enrico Asanohashi. Question about the contest: are dioramas allowed?
Oh my God! Yes, they are. We want our goal for the contest is to be almost as big, if not just a little smaller than GBWC, and because we are actually technically the only truly international contest out there. Like, even Simon can enter because he's in the UK, but. So yes, we want you to give your best. Dioramas, scratch builds, as long as it's not bootleg, it's welcome.
Cool. You know, and that's a really
and it doesn't even have to be Gunpla. It could be Zoids. It could be frame arms. It could be a kitbash of all of them. We just want it to be a robot.
I think I have some old GoBots that from the 1980s that I have. I could paint those.
Well, we actually will accept
GoBot.
That because we actually will accept that because it is a robot. If you want to paint up GoBots.
You're not a true mech head unless you experience GoBots.
True. Clay, what about Evangelion?
An experience.
Even though they're not technically mechs, it's in that mech genre, so we allow it.
Difficult.
Go with the GoBots, my friends. Go with the GoBots. So, but hey, that brings up a really, really
good... I just paint a rock.
That actually brings up a really good topic of conversation and actually transitions into our next question. Seeing that the It's a Gundam contest is open to everybody, every country around the world, no matter where you're from, you can enter. The Mix Emperor Q wants us to think about, you know, he wants our opinions on some of the countries with, you know, kind of growing Gunpla communities being excluded from GBWC. He's from the UK and would love to enter, but the UK is excluded from GBWC competition at the moment. So what do you guys think about that? I mean, everybody on the panel, what are your thoughts?
We're working on that.
We're
working in behind the scenes.
I actually really don't like that, especially in those commercials. It's like they show the countries that are in there, and it's like America, and then all of Asia, and then Italy. And it's like, yeah, really? All of Europe you're going to represent?
It is very popular in Italy, though. That's the thing. It's proportionally different. Mm-hmm. Plus they have distribution, so it's a different story.
Yeah, so it's basically, from my understanding, is it's not included in some other countries because of the perception that it's just not as popular there? Is that why?
It's probably a business decision as well.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, they have sales there.
That's it.
Sure.
Let's be honest, it's really hard to get Gundams in the UK.
Right.
Because I go to UK all the time.
And, oh, do you? Like,
My wife is in Birmingham.
Oh, really? Oh, okay.
Yeah, she's from me. So every time I talk to her or she talks to me, I feel like I'm being mugged.
Thank you for saying that.
She didn't hear me, so it's all right. But yeah, it's really hard to get. You do get some Japanese shop, and occasionally you will get like a random kit in Forbidden Planet. But it is really, really hard to get a hold of in England. Yeah.
Well, there's a couple of retailers now. There's JapanCool.co.uk. It's just been around for a while now, so it is picking up a bit, which is a good thing. So.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Tim, your mic cut out.
We lost Tim.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
We lost him. Oh, no.
Did everybody know sign language?
Come back, leader! Oh.
Just flailing his arms around.
While Tim's coming back, I'll just pose the next question for you guys. Is from King Stargazer, asks, have any of you made your own effect parts, and what is the process you used to make them?
That's good question.
Pretty good, yeah.
How
do you make effect parts?
I made mine by... Effect. By visiting a shop and buying some.
I did
pretty good. If you look close, they're quite detailed.
That's been a great assignment.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah, I don't per se, but actually if you go on our group, one of our admins, Retail, he's actually in the process of doing effect parts and doing tutorials about them, so if you have questions about those, he's the guy to ask. He's making blades like nobody's business. So if you have questions, you should go to the group and ask.
How about Wynn? Have you had any...
Okay, y'all might hate me for this, right? But I don't use effect particle at all. Know, like clear things that I get from Gundam, like the beam sword and all that, I chuck them away. Sorry.
That's the correct answer.
The It's
the correct answer.
Chuck them away.
You can send them to me.
Because, like, I rust mine. A lot of rust. I love rust. Rust is my thing, right? And you put a beam particle or whatever on rust, like, it doesn't look right.
Mm.
It just doesn't look right. Yeah. So I actually never really use them.
I will say that
that's the correct answer, though.
I think we probably all saw this a few months ago. There was that post online, and some of you guys, I'm sure, probably knew about this long before that as well, about, like, cutting up the clear runners and melting it with glue, and you can, like...
Oh, yeah, I saw that.
I tried that. It works pretty well, but it was really bubbly. After, like, reforming it, it's not, like, really clear. So I need to experiment with that some more, but it does kind of work.
Yeah.
All right. Has any of you guys tried that?
Apparently, one of my friends, he used glass sealant. You know, clear glass sealant with a bit of food color.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay, sure.
Just throwing it out there.
I mean, I think, honestly, one of the best ways to get a really good part is, you know, is probably to, you know, scratch build it. In whatever medium, it doesn't have to be clear or anything like that. You know, like epoxy putty is probably one of the best things that comes to mind. Cast it and in clear resin, and then go from there. You know, so that's just what I would do if I used them. But I'm with Wynn. Throw them in the trash. That's me.
Yeah.
Also, just want to update that question I said is from King Stargazer, sorry, that was wrong. Kenji Stargazer. I have it here, the name was wrong. So, anyway, that was wrong.
If I was to make my own effect parts, I'd probably raid the runners that used to have the beam sabers on them, cut them, and maybe if I was doing some funnels for my Sazabi or something, and join them in together, and maybe do some hobby knife trimming of the end so it's like a peg. That's what I think I would try and do. And then you can do the hot water thing to kind of bend it into a little shape like it's shooting the funnel out. That's what I'd imagine I'd try. I haven't tried it yet, though.
I would recommend... I tried using hot water, and it didn't work as well for me. I just use a hairdryer. Works really well.
Yes, nice.
Yeah, I was going to say hairdryer, heat gun if you have it, you know, to get it, to get the plastic pliable. But, yeah, I mean, I think that's another good source, too. And then, you know, once it's pliable, just, you know, take, you know, like, I don't know, anything and just kind of start to pinch at it and make it, you know, irregular, not, you know, the cylindrical shape of a runner. But, yeah, that would be a great idea, too.
Hmm.
So, very cool. So, okay, so here's a good one from our friend Scuffle. Well, my friend Scuffle. We're besties. If you could be Bandai CEO for a day, what is the one kit you'd force the company to produce?
Oh, that's a good question.
PG camphor.
Good choice. I'm gonna take that into a different direction. Not just a kit. I would force them to fight the legalization for that Star Wars stuff so they can get them to America.
I don't think
so. Clay would go totally Emperor Palpatine on us.
Yeah, I would.
Emperor Palpatine.
All right, so what about the rest of you guys? What would your dream kit be for if you were CEO for a day?
I'll get him to do a PG Zaccarello just for fun. just see what it looks like. I wouldn't buy it. I wouldn't be interested in getting it. I just want to see it.
We have a few million. Let's throw it away.
Zach, what about you, man? What would your dream be?
I would say maybe like some master grade from Advanced Zeta, like
yes,
a Dandelion would be awesome. I love the Dandelion. It's like, if you guys don't know, it's kind of like a Zaku Marasai, kind of on top, sort of, and the bottom sort of like a Bondock. Like, it's got that big skirt, like the weird, like, 3-foot leg things.
Wow.
That one's really cool. Or like the Hazel with like the Icarus unit. Ooh, or the big arms.
Yep.
That'd be really cool.
Oh man, I second that. That's great.
With the Zeon arms on it. Or not Zeon, sorry, Psycho Gundam.
Man, Zach's got him. Zach's on point with these answers, man. Good stuff, dude. Dance of Zeta. Rock and roll.
Something like that. Or a RE-100, what's the Solomon Express.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Massive guns on it.
Yeah.
Jeez, you guys are blowing me away with all your knowledge. I feel like a total noob here.
I would say that, what's that other unit? So now I can't remember the name. The unit from Solomon Express where it's like a dom, but it doesn't have legs, or that really long cannon.
Yeah, what's it? It's Jupiter. Chat, help us out. What's the name of it? Come on, quickly. Come on, chat.
No.
You're failing us, chat.
Yeah, that sounds right. It's Jupiter something. Anyway.
Yeah. It escapes me because that's my favorite one from Solomon Express.
Super cool.
But first mind fart right now. I can't remember what the hell the damn name is right now. So.
All of those are great for the RE-100 line.
I'm sure the chat will catch up with us at some point, and someone will look it up and give us the name. And as soon as you do, we'll mention your name in the in here and just real quick. So, what would your dream kit to make if you were CEO? What would yours be?
Oh, PG gun. PG Camphor. I love Camphor.
Yeah.
It came out for like one episode. But it's that build up towards that one single episode and he got killed. But it's awesome. It's like just the epitome of awesomeness, personally anyway. I just really, really like the Camphor design. Like, I think personally a good design is, you know, when you just get the silhouette and you know exactly what it is, that's a good design.
Mm-hmm.
And you definitely get that with Camphor. I don't know, it just looks awesome and evil. I love it.
That was a cool mech, I gotta admit, but such a disappointment just on one episode. It was just like, man, bring it back, bring it back. So
I mean, they kind of tried with the Amazing Camphor with the Build Fighter, but it wasn't the same.
Yeah,
you know, it lacked that grittiness and that like the evil meanness to it.
Yeah. Well, it's like bring it back in canon. Bring it back in an actual UC show. You know, that's what I want to say.
Maybe what some of us should do is instead of having a kit brought out, is we make them start all these animations, including all these MSs that we like, and then they have to make the kits to recoup the money for all the animation that they spent.
that's what they do anyway.
Yeah.
That's a good answer there, Josh. That's a good, good answer.
Yep. Where we can see Crossbone in anime.
Yeah.
Ooh, nice.
I didn't think of one. I'd love to see. I wouldn't actually like it myself, but I'd love to see MG Bear Guy Verka. Just purely to see its box art, white background, and the Bear Guy standing there all tough next to like the cement sign and stuff, and actually have a full inner frame and open hatches and everything, that'd be just great, yeah.
With loads of those decals with the little circles on it.
Yeah, tiny ones, yep.
Nice.
And be filled with cotton candy.
All right, so we have a winner on that name. Enrico Asa Nohashi is our winner. He has won just a mention here on the show, but Jupiter's Ghost was the name that crazy and modified deep strikerish Dom from Solomon's Express. So congratulations to him. Your prize will be in the mail very shortly. So you know, I gotta say, for mine, you know, if I was CEO for a day, I'd go simple, man. I'd want a Blue Destiny Verka. Man, Kotoki's version of the Blue Destiny from his books, it's just beautiful. Just beautiful. And honestly, if you've ever seen my Blue Destiny that I did, I based it off of his design. So that would be my choice. So I went simple. So
nice. Cool.
Very good, very good. So, all right, so let's see what we got. Time for maybe one more question here. What do we got? Let's see what we can find here for a good one. Okay, so this one is for Wynn. It comes from Apoc Strike. So he's looking at all of the books in the background there, and he's wondering what percentage of those are Gunpla books.
I have one Gunpla book. Sorry.
Probably not the answer he wanted to hear.
I don't grab it anymore, but I just, literally just the one. Most of it is art and design book. Like that bit is comic, psychology book over that way. Like art, and then there's magic. Not the Gathering, the actual like. Conjuration, right? Magic, magician kind of thing, not actual, real. But it's like, it's just mainly design, psychology, and right stuff, basically. Yeah, just random books. I like the look of, or I just find it interesting. Yeah.
Did you just buy all the books this morning and put them behind so we'd be impressed by all your library?
Yeah, right. No, it's the other way around. Actually, he just took like a couple of pictures with him to the library, and that's where he is now.
That's actually a set. It's a photo. It's actually just a photo set.
You took my joke.
Real. None of it is real.
Oh, Zach is on point on this one, ladies and gentlemen.
That was good.
Zach is on point. Good job, Zach. Very good. Very good. All right. So let's get a couple more here. We got like about a little less than 10 minutes. So let's do some speed questions here. All right. So this one is from Chiba Meta. He wants to start painting, but he doesn't really know where and how to start. He's afraid to ruin the kits that he loves because he loves like scratch builds and modified builds. So. In all of your guys' opinions, how does somebody start, getting into painting?
Go in.
If you want to go for either, go for SD first, and then you go into that one, or just go balls to the walls. Mm-hmm. Right? Seriously, just do it. Balls to the walls and just do it. If worst comes to worst, get a new one. That is it, right? Or just do it to the best of your ability, right? Leave it for a bit, go do other kit, and then once you build up your skill, come back and just refine what you've done beforehand. Because, like, your style will always be your style. You just add new tool and knowledge to what you do. So, basically, after you get all that, you go back to that kit, right? It's like, I can redo that, so you redo that bit. Or I can redo that bit, and it'll come up slowly with that kit you start off with. So I say balls to the walls, go for it. Don't be afraid.
Yep.
Correct answer. Good job.
I remember when you're starting out and you buy one kit and the idea of spending any money on another kit, you don't really like that idea because you don't want to waste your money. So I recommend what Wynn said: get a little SD, so it's maybe $10 or $15, and that way you're not too worried about wrecking it. Yeah, that's what I recommend too. Mm.
Yep.
Cool.
The SD thing is what I would do too, and just go all out.
Yep.
If you mess up, you mess up. You learn from it.
That's it.
All right. Life is hard. Deal with it.
Wow.
Whoa. All
right. That escalated quickly.
Next question.
Nah, I'm kidding. Go for it, buddy. Good luck with that.
Next question here, quick hitter, from Marcus Hackmeister. What is the best plastic plate to use?
Kamiya plot plate only.
Yeah, I got enough. Sorry, I'd never use them. Sorry.
Zach's one of those guys. You gotta use plot plate.
Have you guys ever used Evergreen?
Yeah.
Yeah.
People ask me about Evergreen. Yeah. And I've never used it, but I know they sell it everywhere in Japan, so.
That's the only thing I can get, so. I can't get Plawflate, so. I just get what I can. And I've actually seen people just use other things like popsicle sticks and just folders, credit cards, and it works. Wow. Just expired credit cards, sand off the numbers and use it as Plawflate because it's styrene.
Wow.
Yeah.
I also recommend if you only need a little bit, because you know I don't paint, cut off the little name part on the runner of the sheet that you're using from, and it'll actually match the color that you're putting it with. You don't get a lot of plastic, but it's something you can use.
Now, Jim's back.
Hey, Jim. Guys.
Hey.
I can answer the question.
Uh-oh.
I use two types. One is, can you see it, evergreen. It comes with a bunch of sizes. You look at the back of the sheet. And it comes in, you know, in fractions of an inch. I mean, to very small to very thick. And another company that I also like a lot is Fastrupt. You can get these on eBay or Amazon or whatever. I don't know overseas if you can get them. But the good thing about this company is that they don't only do Plawflate, but they also do, like, rods and beams and, like, if you want a square, like a square quote-unquote rod, you can get that. I mean, just check out the website. There's just a bunch of – they're, like, specialists on providing plastic products for scratch builders, model makers, all that stuff. So that's what I do. And, if you can be creative, some people use, the for sale signs – that are made of plastic. I've seen people online use a plastic from bottles and stuff like that. And I mean, you can just be creative. And if it works, if it's plastic, go for it.
Excellent. And guys, you know me. I modified the crap out of my model, so I go through a lot of plastic. I'm going to. Basically recommend everything that everybody said. Evergreen strips and shapes and everything are awesome. If you can get those, man, they save so much time. So much time. Excellent scratch building materials. Plastruct is another great company. They make a ton of structural components, girders and beams and stairs and anything almost you can think of. Find their website, find a distributor wherever you might live, and if you're into that, if you want to get into that, easy resource of getting simple shapes. Just straight sheet styrene, I use a couple different places. Yeah, I get Plawflate for the really thin stuff, like the 0.30 millimeter, and then like half millimeter, because that's what I use most. But for 1 millimeter, Amazon. You can get a lot of good plastic on Amazon, even on Prime. And if you're in the States, there is a really good company, and you should all take advantage of it, called McMaster Carr. They're a tool company, actually, and really just kind of hardware and all sorts of stuff. But they sell raw materials, including sheet styrene. And their sheet styrene comes in thicknesses of up to an inch thick. Not that I would ever use that, but it's available if you need it. If you want to really go to town on an inch sheet of plastic, man, they have it for you. And they come in big sizes, too. I mean, you can get like a 2-foot by 4-foot sheet of plastic if you need it. And they're not that expensive compared to, what you get with, the evergreen sheets and the Plastruct sheets and stuff like that. So definitely check out McMaster Carr, great company. I've ordered from them from a lot of different times in the past, and a lot of different products too, not just plastic. So they're really, really good. That's what I would use. I kind of use a mix of a lot of different sources. MicroMark in the U.S. is a really good source
different things as well, especially buildings and train, you know, sorted supplies for dioramas and stuff. So check out Micromark as well. But that's kind of my catalog of vendors, if you will. So there it is. So all right, so it looks like that's our time. I want to thank everyone. I want to thank the viewers. I want to thank my awesome co-hosts. I want to thank Mr. Clay, and most of all, for waking up at the butt crack of dawn. And it looks like the sun is up there already, so that's a good thing.
It is.
Grand champion, GBWC winner, Mr. Win Imong. That's awesome. Man, thank you so much for joining us. It was a pleasure having you.
Pleasure is mine, sir.
Cool. All right, gentlemen and ladies, if you're watching, I know there was one from Germany that a bunch of people jumped on there. Watch it, guys. Don't be a creeper. You know, until next time, we bid you adieu, and watch our next show sometime next month.
Yeah, just stay tuned to our Facebook page. If you guys haven't liked our Facebook page, that's where we'll post the updates for that.
So. Yeah, like our Facebook page, man. And a bunch of our Instagrams and stuff like that, and like whatever Wynn is doing, and like whatever Clay is doing. That is that's good too. And like some stuff.
Just like that, everything you see, just like it all.
Like it, man. Yeah, do your job. Come on,
like everything.
We deserve it. You put on this awesome show.
There you go.
All right, that's all I got. I'm done. I'm out of here. All right. Until next time, everybody.
All right, later, guys.
Enjoy.
Good talking to y'all.
Bye.
See you. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.